Find the inverse of f of x for f of x equals x plus 3 quantity squared when x is greater than or equal to negative 3. What I like to do when I'm finding the inverse is to graph the function. You don't necessarily need to graph it, but sometimes it makes it easier. So this x plus 3 quantity squared has a vertex at 0, negative 3, and I'll put a couple more points down just to help me sketch this. It goes up pretty steep there. I'm not going to draw the other half of the parabola because I have this here. I have this x is greater than or equal to negative 3, so we're just going to limit this parabola, or cut it in half, if you want to say it. Now, what I like to do when I'm finding the inverse function is I like to just lay down what we usually are asked for, and that's the inverse function, the domain, and the range. Okay, the inverse, we'll be getting to that. The domain, well, the domain of the inverse function equals the range of the original function. And the range of this is just everything greater than 0, all y greater than 0. That's the range of the original function, everything there. So if the domain of the inverse is the range of the original, then I'm going to put this down in the domain of the inverse. So I have the domain of the inverse is including 0. We can include 0. And then increasing without bound. We can't say to infinity. It just increases without bound. We also know that the range, if we want to find the range of the inverse, we know that that equals the domain of the original function. And they tell us the domain. This is the domain of the original. So I'm just going to put some arrows there. The domain of the original is x is greater than or equal to negative 3. We could see it here as well. It just goes on forever. So I'm going to write that down. In fact, I'll write it down in red here just to keep these separated. So the range of the inverse is going to be from negative 3, including negative 3, and then increasing to the right without bound. Or for the inverse, it'd be increasing up without bound. Okay, so I have the domain and the range. Now I just need the inverse. Why did they indicate that x is greater than or equal to 0? Why did they cut this off? Well, they cut this off because they wanted us to know that this function was 1-to-1. That horizontal line test says, yes, this is 1-to-1, so this does have an inverse. Okay, so the process for finding an inverse is like this. You set the function equal to y. So y equals x plus 3 quantity squared. Now you're going to solve for x. And to solve for x, we're going to need to take the square root of each side. And when you take the square root to solve, you're going to say plus or minus. And we'll deal with that in a second here. So just for the time being, let's say plus or minus the square root of y equals x plus 3. But we know that x, so far, we know that x is greater than or equal to negative 3. So we know that we're only going to take the positive of this square root. All right, so we will take out that negative, and then we just have the positive square root of y. So now we'll go ahead and subtract 3 from each side. And we get, as a result, the square root of y, and then minus 3 outside of the radical, equals x. And then the last thing you do to write the inverse is to make this equal to, just swap the x and the y is what you need to do. Swap the x and the y. And I'm just going to show what we're doing there. And now written in a new color, we have the inverse of x then equals the square root of x minus 3. All right, so I'm going to write that over here just to finish this. That's the square root of x minus 3. Remember that the minus 3 there is not under the radical. So here we have the inverse, the domain, and the range. And just real quickly again, we said y equals the original function, solve for x, and because of our limitations here, we can take away the negative on the plus or minus when we take the square root to solve, because if we plugged in something less than negative 3, this would become negative, and we can't have a negative here. And we are not plugging anything in that is less than negative 3. And then you finish solving, and then just swap the x and y, and now you have the inverse of x equals what is left there. All right, so that is how you find the inverse of a function.